You know, this is going to be latest in a series, new series of podcasts we've been doing on interesting historical photos in NHL history. We did a photo the other day of a story on Guy Lafleur getting his 1,000 point with Mario cheering him on in the background of Montreal Forum. But I want you to look at the first photo in this sequence. You recognize the guy on the left, right? Of course, it's the Rocket. You recognize the person in the middle. Yeah, it's the Gumper. This is a game between Montreal and New York, I think, in the late 1950s. But who's the guy on the right-hand side? Well, he looks like a prototypical New York Rangers player of the 1950s, tough and, you know, willing to step down. You can see here he's not going to start a stick-swinging duel with the Rocket, but the way he's doing it, you know, if you're ready to go, I'm ready to go. Now, this guy was one of the most beloved players ever to play in the NHL back in the, what they call the glorious 1950s. Ivan Duane Irwin, who passed away in Ajax, Ontario in 2019 after a long and successful life, both on and off the ice at age 91. Now, why Mr. Irwin is so relevant to the modern day, he's one of a misnomer. He only got interested in hockey at the age of 16, and within a couple of years, he was all the way into pro hockey, and then after playing with Montreal, with the Rangers in the NHL. Now, born on March 13, 27 in Chicago, we're going to be narrating this podcast with our good friends of Hockey Then and Now, blogspot.com, who did a story on Ivan's life when he passed away in 2019. Now, according to the report, he didn't become interested in hockey until he was 16. As one writer noted, he picked up the game like a natural, improving with finesse in every outing. In 1944, he skated a handful of games for the Northern Vocational High School in Toronto and played midget hockey for the Scarborough Colts. In a 3-1 loss against the Sammy Taft Midgets on February 1544, the Toronto Daily Star observed that Ivan Irwin was a standout for the losers. Now, he eventually played junior B hockey in the OHA with the Scarborough Rangers. His work on the blue line didn't go unnoticed. After one playoff game in March 46, the Globe and Mail noted, but the real star of a magnificent exhibition was tall blonde Ivan Irwin, Rangers right defenseman who belted De La Salle Oakland's high school into submission in the first two periods, scoring a goal and made plays for two others. In this book, Irwin is the best prospect to be seen here in several years. Now, in April 47, he was selected to play in the tournament featuring youngsters from Ontario in a series of East versus West contests held at Maple Leaf Gardens. His coach on the East squad was former Toronto Maple Leaf great Charlie Conacher. After ending his pro career, Irwin would once again lace up his skates to play for the NHL Oldtimers with Conacher's son Peter. When Irwin wasn't playing hockey, he traded his hockey gloves for a baseball glove. On a pleasant summer night in July 45, Jerry Junkin pitched his fifth consecutive victory in a Scarborough Softball League contest. Junkin was a member of the Hollywood Wolves in the Pacific Coast League in 44-45. A newspaper report informed that all being on a losing team, Ivan Irwin started for the Wrights against Junkin Evans' team. After junior hockey, he began a one-year stint for the Boston Olympics in 1948. His progression as a rough physical defenseman continued with the Olympics. In a Quebec Senior Hockey League game against the Ottawa Senators, Irwin went toe-to-toe with Senators tough guy Jack Irvin. His nickname, Ivan the Terrible, reflected his style of play. He stood at 6'2 and weighed 185. Irwin's size enabled him to manhandle the opposition and protect his teammates. Now, while playing in the next two seasons with Sherbrooke in the QSHL, Irwin's career was on the rise. In the autumn of 49, the AHL Cincinnati Mohawks gave him a three-game tryout. His first coach in Cincy was the legendary Francis King Clancy. He made most of the opportunity and remained with the Mohawks. Now, Cincinnati scribe Whitney Tower wrote that Irwin was an unpolished as 185-pound chunk of pig iron and just about as hard to dent, and was a smash from the start. Irwin eventually worked on fine-tuning his game, in particular when it came to being noticed by the referees, and as Towers would later point out, he was using legal methods instead of grabbing his man around the throat and doing him in like a desperate commando. Now, Irwin's coach in 52, Clint Schmidt, was impressed with his big defender. He's as good as any defenseman in the league, stated the former NHL star. Now, this is where his career turned, ladies and gentlemen. On October 3rd, 51, he became the property of the Montreal Canadiens in a cash deal, but he remained in Cincinnati. Now, on March 16, 52, the Cincinnati Gardens and Mohawk Boosters Club honored Irwin before a tilt against the Pittsburgh Hornets. The event was billed as Ivan Irwin Night. Now, in 53, Irwin finally got a chance to participate in an NHL regular season contest. He skated in four games with the Habs and earned his first point by assisting on a goal. Unable to earn a roster spot with the Habs, he was sent to Victoria Cougars of the WHL. In 58 games for Victoria, he recorded 25 points in 119 penalty minutes. An off-season trade in August 55 between Montreal and New York sent Irwin to the Rangers in exchange for Eddie Slowinski and Pete Babando. Now, Irwin started the 54 season with the WHL Vancouver Canucks, but in early November was called up by the Rangers to replace Alan Stanley, who was out with an injury. Now, on November 5th, 53, Irwin participated in his first contest with the Blue Shirts. Early reviews of his performance on Broadway were positive. "He's all I thought he was and more," said Irwin's most important critic, his coach, Frank Boucher. "I wondered if he was a sound-thinking fellow, whether he might be wild and willing and get foolish penalties." Without missing a beat, Boucher laid to rest any fears he had about Irwin's discipline on the ice. "Why, he's cool and smart. He doesn't get excited. You're thinking of the league for 5 years." Now, Boucher helped heap further praise on a new addition to his back end. "He gives you that little opening that closes. Bang your head and you don't forget it." The Rangers boss did eliminate his comments or runs on ice activities. Although he doesn't say a lot, he says the right thing at the right time. That helps pep up the team in the dressing room. Now, how tough was Ivan Irwin? Now, the photo that we just showed of Rocket and Mr. Irwin gives a good indication. It shows Irwin ready to go stick to stick against the Rocket. Known for his temper and ability to act on same, Richard, with eyes glaring in his photo, you can tell he was an intimidating player. But it didn't cause Irwin to retreat. He stood his ground and was ready to battle Richard. Now, from 54 to 58, he played in 151 games with the Big League Club and 144 with the Providence Reds. Including this stretch was a Calder Cup title with the Reds in 56. He was also an AHL first team with Providence in 58 and 59. Now, at the age of 33, he closed up his pro career in 1960 after spending two seasons with the AHL's Buffalo Bisons. Unfortunately, during a car ride home with his dad to Ontario from an exhibition game in Buffalo, Irwin made a decision on his future in the game. In that contest, he suffered a nasty gash to his head. By the time father and son reached St. Catharines, Irwin chose to call it a career. Now, Irwin continued to play hockey when he joined the NHL Oldtimers. "Playing serious hockey is in our ballgame," an article quoted Irwin when it came to the entertainment factor for his new team. Part of Irwin's act included donning a wig, then offering no resistance as others dumped a pail of water over his head. Drenched in water, it was his turn to steal the spotlight. Irwin took off his wig and, in a twisting and squeezing motion, extracted the water. Now, when the NHL Oldtimers held a dinner to honor Carl Brewer in April 97, the four-time Stanley Cup winner with Toronto touched on Irwin the man and hockey player. "I've never met anyone who enjoyed life more, laughed better, or played the game better or harder than Ivan Irwin," stated Brewer. "When I think back on the dressing room stories, the guys talk about Ivan playing the old Quebec League, playing for New York, playing whatever he was, but he was always laughing." Now, Brewer also commented on the weekly gathering at the ice. "We play on Sunday mornings now and nothing has changed. Ivan's out there with his feet. You can't get by him. The hands, he doesn't have hands. He has paws. The odd time during the course of the morning, he'll sneak up to the front of the net, think he should get a goal. And he never has. But what I know is he's always laughing. He enjoys life. It makes life better for everyone." So with our podcast here at the channel, we want to celebrate what I consider, not say unheralded players, but players who played for the love of the game. And Ivan Irwin, I've heard stories about this guy for years, but his reputation of being dedicated, like to put this in perspective, by 1943 he was learning to play hockey and being a multi-sport athlete like he was. Can you imagine if you got a kid in grade 10 in high school decides to go out for hockey and he's in the NHL within 5 years? That never happens in 2021. Can you imagine the demands he would have? You would probably say to one kid, "Well, when did you start hockey?" "Oh, I was 9 or 10 on his backyard rink." "And when did you start?" "Well, I thought I'd give it a shot." And again, no matter how many years the NHL has played, you look at that photo of Rocket and Ivan, that sums up what the 1950s were. You had the great superstars, but you had the role players like Ivan Irwin that didn't want to step down because, you know, stepping down wasn't a choice. He had to put food on the table for himself and his family, and that's what's going on. So that's the story of the great Ivan Irwin. If you like what we're doing here, give us a like, comment, or subscribe. And don't forget, when you go to an NHL old-timers game, just remember, you're seeing legends on the ice and show them great respect. Because I've met a lot of old-timers through my life, for the Habs, the Bruins, Atlanta Flames, Rangers, all different squads. And let me tell you something. How many people go to an NHL old-timers game and the memories that come back? Millions? Billions of memories? When I saw the Montreal Canadiens come to Woodstock in 2010, they had Richer, Lafleur, Sévigné, Lambert, Mameso, all the memories of these players were just rolling back. The players, the moments. The radio games where it would fade out and you would hear, you had to stop the car to get what the last and the third period was going to be because Montreal was ahead 3-2. Or the only shift in a Montreal game on Hockey Night in Canada and you were listening to the last 20 minutes of a game where Montreal was ahead 9-2, you're no longer going to win the fulfillment of that, eh? Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for listening, and to all our Montreal Canadiens fans out there, better times are coming. Thanks for listening. Bye.